Welcome to Season 3 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Josh Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement and a former Secretary of Maryland's Health Department. Our goal is to bring scientific evidence and experience to the public health news of the day through informative interviews with scientists, community leaders, policy experts, public health officials, clinicians, and more. If you have ideas or questions for us to cover, please email us at publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. Today, our topic may make you sleepy, which would be a good thing. I talked to Dr. Rachel Salas, a neurologist and sleep specialist at the Johns Hopkins Center for Sleep and Wellness. We discuss how COVID-19 is keeping people up at night and what can be done about it. Let's listen. It's great to have you, Dr. Salas, to talk to us about sleep and COVID-19. Tell us what you're seeing in patients.
Yeah, well, thanks for having me. I would say that initially when the pandemic first hit, we were seeing patients that were coming in reporting issues getting asleep or staying asleep, which is insomnia. But it was mostly because of the fear, either of getting COVID or a loved one getting COVID or losing their job. You know, there was that kind of fear surrounding. However, in the last month or so, we're now starting to see patients come in who had COVID, had symptoms, recovered, and now for the first time are having pretty severe sleep issues.
So tell me about those sleep issues. Is it just insomnia or insomnia plus other kinds of problems?
I think it's a little bit of a combo. We're definitely seeing insomnia. That's the more common issue, which is either the problem getting asleep or waking up and not being able to go back to sleep within 30 minutes. But we're also seeing issues with the circadian rhythm being off. And I think that may not necessarily be due to the virus, but also the schedules that people are having. Many people are working from home. Their schedules are not as strict as maybe they were before. And so that's kind of feeding into all of the sleep disturbances they're experiencing.
Yeah, and I certainly didn't mean to minimize it by saying just insomnia. I think insomnia can be pretty severe, and I'm sure patients, by the time they reach you, are having really serious trouble with their lives.
Yeah, insomnia is the most common sleep disorder that we see in patients that present to our center. But insomnia in itself can be its own disorder, but it can also be a symptom. So part of our job is really to identify, are these patients that have something else going on that's causing the insomnia, the symptom? But what we're finding in terms of COVID and those that have recovered, those long haulers is what they're calling them, that are now presenting with insomnia, they don't have another cause. Like they don't have apnea, for example, that's waking them up. It's purely this severe insomnia. And then a lot of them are also experiencing some sleep-related anxiety, which they had never felt before.
So could you give me an example of a typical patient? Like they show up in your office and what do they tell you?
Yeah, so they'll come in and they'll say, and I will say that many of them have recently been frontline healthcare workers, right? That they got COVID and have gotten better. But they're coming in saying that they've never had issues getting asleep or waking up. They've never had these issues really with sleep disruption at all. And now what they're doing is they're not able to get to sleep. They have multiple awakenings throughout the night and they have a pretty pronounced sleep-related anxiety. So kind of they worry even before getting into bed because they know their sleep is not going to be good. And that's a phenomenon that we've seen for a long time in chronic insomnia where it kind of feeds the insomnia. And I would say that that has been a major symptom of these patients that have recovered from COVID.
And then with the circadian rhythm disturbances, you're seeing people who are primarily sleeping during the day?
Yeah, so their schedule is just off. Like they're not able to maintain a consistent bedtime and awakening time. And because of that, that also can contribute to negatively affecting their insomnia because the timing's off. And we know from studies that even if you get 10 hours of sleep, if it's not in line with our natural circadian rhythm, you actually function like a sleep-deprived person.
What do you think is going on? Do you think that it is the stress and anxiety of having had COVID, wondering about the future, you know, the trauma, maybe for healthcare workers, that is being reflected in insomnia? Or do you think there's a biological
pathway that is directly related to the coronavirus itself?
Yeah, I think the answer is going to be probably a combination of several different things. And my colleagues in neurology are, you know, doing research and looking at the effects of the virus directly on the nervous system. We know that patients who get COVID, they lose their sense of smell, taste, they're having fatigue, insomnia, headaches, other neurological symptoms. So my colleagues are really trying to see what the effect of the virus is. I certainly agree that there probably is a relationship there, but also feeding into this is definitely the anxiety associated with the virus, not feeling like you were before you were infected. And then with just everything going on in the world, I mean, we've had a tough year, and I think people feel lonely, they feel siloed. There's just all these other things that are factoring in, making this insomnia particularly cumbersome to address.
So what are the kinds of things that you do for patients to help them with these really debilitating symptoms?
Regardless if insomnia is related to COVID, post-COVID, you know, recovery or not, chronic insomnia, the treatment strategy and the management is the same. So the big thing is for us to first identify that there's not anything else going on, like, you know, like I mentioned, obstructive sleep apnea. Many people have that. 80% of people out there have it that are not diagnosed. So we want to make sure there's not something else going on. And once that's done.
So for example, you want to make sure that you say, well, what do you have to drink before you go to sleep? And people say, I have my sixth cup of coffee that day.
Right. So environmental sleep hygiene practices, things like that. Yes, we go through all of that. And really the gold standard treatment strategy is working with a sleep behavioral psychologist on our team to come up with a personalized, customized treatment strategy for the patient. Because each one of us, you know, we all have environmental factors. Everybody has different stressors. We all handle stress differently. So they come up with a customized plan for that individual right there. And, you know, it involves behavioral modification, maybe some mindfulness, just a lot of other strategies that are not medication related. And that's what's been shown to have the best outcome.
How good are those outcomes?
They're actually pretty good. I guess the more complex part of it is that a lot of it obviously relies on the patient and their motivation and their environment and, you know, what stressors they have going on. But they do meet with a sleep behavioral psychologist for like 6 to 8 sessions, depending. And, you know, there's almost always some benefit, and some patients maybe more than others, depending on what other things they have going on. But that's really where the benefit will be.
And what about people who may be listening in places that it's not so easy to find a sleep behavioral therapist? What do you recommend for them?
So I definitely recommend talking with your clinician, so your doctor, about your sleep issues. I think a lot of times people don't make sleep a priority and don't talk to their doctor about it. So I think that's the first step. I will say that with the COVID presence, a lot of leniency has been done in terms of telemedicine. So you may be surprised that you may be able to actually see a sleep specialist, even though you're not, one's not down the road. So I'd start with your primary care provider first and then go from there.
I know there are a lot of gadgets out there to help you sleep. Is that part of what you may use for someone? Or?
Yeah, so I think there's a lot more sleep awareness nowadays, and patients definitely are realizing that sleep is actually a basic human need and we all need it. And there's a lot of devices out there that bring awareness. However, you got to be careful, because there's actually a name, we call it orthosomnia. So sometimes people will buy a Fitbit or an Apple, you know, something that's giving them information. And it turns out that actually causes their insomnia, because they'll see like, oh my God, I didn't get enough REM sleep last night. I thought I slept good, but I'm not getting enough REM sleep. And I know REM sleep's important for memory. And so it actually causes a sleep issue. So you want to be careful. But yes, we do use the devices. They can be helpful if used right.
Great. Well, thank you both for describing this problem and giving some hope that people can make progress with it. I appreciate your joining me today.
Yeah, thanks for having me again.
Public Health On Call is produced by Josh Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmond. Audio production by Spencer Greer, Niall Owen McCusker, C.N. Oates, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. production support from Catherine Ricardo and Neiman Outlin. Social media support from Brenda Hageter, Grace Holes Fernandez, and Caroline Wong. Thank you for listening.